In Namibia, one woman has resolved to devote all her efforts to saving the world's fastest animal, the cheetah, from extinction. All her time is spent on the task. We're about to meet Laurie Marker, an extraordinary woman living a remarkable life.
Oh, I think the cheetah's life is very important for the planet, not just because I like it, although I do think the cheetah's the most amazing animal there is on the face of the earth. But I think that for a variety of reasons, and one of it is to the benefit that it has to the ecosystem.
In any ecosystem, including this sparsely wooded savanna in southern Africa, all the animals are interconnected. As the main predator here, the cheetah plays an essential role in maintaining a healthy balance of nature. Inhabiting prairies and wide open spaces, the cheetah is as important to human well-being as it is to the regulation of gazelle populations. By reducing the number of gazelles, the cheetah helps conserve their feeding areas and strengthen their species. Like all predators, cheetahs are opportunists. Today, a young Thompson's gazelle is paid for a moment of inattention with its life. Male cheetahs form relationships and spend their lives together. Theirs is an endangered species. Today, the number of cheetahs has fallen dramatically. There are thought to be only 10,000 individuals left in 20 or so African countries, while at the start of the 20th century, there were more than 100,000. The two brothers have barely begun their feast when they're forced to retreat, leaving the carcass to carrion feeders. In the eternal cycle of life and death, hunter and prey run neck and neck. At the Ojivirongo Cheetah Conservation Fund Center in Namibia, Laurie Marker's teams are at work. On a routine tour of an enclosure, a young scientist saw two cheetahs fighting. A slash of claws opened up the shoulder of Shadow, the center's most senior resident. She'll have to be put under and taken to the veterinary unit.
Shadow!
The aptly named Shadow is particularly wary. They finally locate her. Shadow hasn't eaten for a day. The lure of a chunk of meat overcomes her instinctive urge to hide herself.
Do you see her, Ryan? Okay.
The dart found its target, but didn't work properly. They have to start over again. A little tense, Gabrielle prepares another dose of anesthetic.
Okay, but I think we should get up as close, a little bit closer with the car.
Attracted by the meat left on the grass, the animal returns. Once again, Gabrielle's aim is perfect and her shot hits the target dead on. But the run of bad luck continues. The dart's triggering mechanism has failed to release the anesthetic. A third attempt might kill the cat, so the operation is halted for the day. In 1990, to save cheetahs from extinction, Laurie Marker set up the CCF, the Cheetah Conservation Fund.
My first job with animals was at the wildlife park, and I started there in the early 70s in their veterinary clinic and the children's zoo, where I had a bunch of small animals that I took care of. But it was the cheetahs that fascinated me most. I just was very interested. Nobody knew much about them, and so I just thought, my God, people have had cheetahs around for 5,000 years. Why don't we know more about them? From that, I ended up doing a research project here in Namibia. taking a cheetah that had been born in captivity over here and teaching it how to hunt, which was a pioneering program at that point in time. I kept coming back to Africa. I ended up in Namibia several more times, in East Africa, Botswana, in the different cheetah range countries, and kept looking at the problems facing the cheetah. The cheetah numbers were declining throughout their range. And every time I came back to Namibia, I found that there was still habitat, there was wildlife, that I decided to set up a foundation and actually come here and put boots on the ground and actually save this population for future generations.
Promoting awareness of the need to protect cheetahs begins in the classroom. This morning, Lori and Ignatius are continuing their long campaign.
Hello.
Hi there.
Dr. Lori Maka loves cheetahs very much, and she wants to teach us in Namibia and all the world that we should love cheetahs also very much.
How many of them have seen a cheetah on their farm?
Oh, I don't like a mama.
Really? How many of you have cattle? Do any of you have horses? Do you? How many of you ride a horse? Everybody. Me too.
Sharing the world's gifts is like a new breath of life for Lori Marker.
I had a great childhood. I was the youngest of my family. I had my dog, so when we did move from Michigan to California, my dog had to go with us. And my dad always says that I wouldn't go to sleep unless I had my dog with me. He was a small terrier dog. He was really cute. His name was Socks. I grew up in a rural area. We had my horses in the backyard. I had rabbits. I spent most all my time on the back of my horse. And as I was a young child, I would follow behind the veterinarians, holding the equipment and the tools. So I knew when I was young that I really had a great interest in the medical care also of animals. I had two brothers who were older than me, and my mom always said, you know, you can do anything you want to do. You can be anything you want to be. So she gave me that growing up to make me realize that I was totally equal. And when I was with my brothers, I always figured that anything they could do, I could do equally, if not better. And if you look at how you were raised, it sort of puts you into the perspective of who you are and maybe why you do what you do.
Namibia is the capital of the cheetahs. That's why we are so fortunate to have this lady.
Dad, I know all of you know a lot about the cheetah.
For Lori, education is the sesame, the cornerstone to understanding our world.
Aru.
Lori Marker begins each day with an unchanging ritual, riding and training her horses. During this moment of peace and quiet, her mind can roam freely and come up with new ideas. It is a special time when, just for a moment, the animal's life isn't simply about survival. At last, the vets and volunteers have managed to anesthetize the shadow. The wound is now days old and necrosis is setting in. After a few routine tests, it's time to take the cheetah to the operating suite. To reduce her stress, they have to work quickly. An animal's life is always a great responsibility. The female is immediately intubated to assist her breathing. Now it's time to see how serious the wound is. Could it already be too late?
Anybody need any cheetah fur for their collection?
Gabrielle uncovers the wound. Meanwhile, Laurie Marker busies herself removing ticks from the animal's coat. Unfortunately, the wound cannot be stitched in its present state. The subcutaneous tissue has been exposed and is heavily infected by bacteria. It must be scraped to clean the wound and let it heal faster. While the animal's under, they give her a general checkup. Shadow is the center's oldest resident. She's 13, quite old for a cheetah. Although cheetahs have a life expectancy of about 20 years in captivity, they only live to 13 on average in the wild.
That makes me happier.
Okay, I did front line.
Thank you.
A cheetah is between 1.20 meters and 1.50 meters long. An adult weighs 35 to 65 kilograms with an average of 48 kilos for males and 38 kilos for females. Gabrielle gives the animal a shot to bring her around.
Looks good.
There we go. Good girl.
The operation's over. Okay, it's been a great success given the age of the cheetah. Shadow has been saved and is in excellent shape.
See her swallow?
Still a little groggy, Shadow returns to the open air. She'll convalesce in a smaller enclosure than the one where she usually roams, away from her fellow cats. The center currently holds about 50 cheetahs. Laurie and the center's volunteers welcome visitors every day. Training sessions for the residents provide a good opportunity to demonstrate the cat's remarkable abilities. The technique is rudimentary, a lure attached to a rope moved by battery power. The cheetahs love it. A cheetah can cover 7 to 8 meters in a single bound and do so 4 times a second. A sprint takes it up to 70 kilometers an hour in 1 second and 90 a second later.
They're not releasable animals. They've come in as very, very small cats. So that means they're not afraid of us, and they've needed us from the time they were tiny babies. But we keep them all exercised. The cats that are here all run behind with the lure.
With a top speed of up to 110 kilometers an hour, the cheetah is the world's fastest land animal. However, it can only keep that speed up over 300 or 400 meters. Its entire body is built for pace. It is slim with long, slender legs, and a highly flexible backbone. Its very wide nostrils allow the high oxygen intake its muscles require. It uses its non-retractable claws as track spikes, and its long tail helps it balance as it runs.
Great. They'll sleep well tonight. A philosophy of nature, I think, is that we can live together, and that we are the ones in control of nature. And with that, we need to be the ones helping understand it, teach it, and live with it.
At the center, education is still a key issue for Laurie Marker.
Good to see you. Parlez-vous français?
Today, 4 new fund ambassadors are to be presented to the public.
When we get them in at 3 weeks of age, they needed to be on baby bottles. And they were only about this big. When you raise them on baby bottles, this is how they act. They are not animals that could go back out into the wild because they don't have the skills. They'd be following behind mom. They'd be learning how to chase, understanding what it would be to hunt. But actually learning how to hunt is something that they learn At this age, on for the next about 6 months. Baby girl, you guys did great. Come up, 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 up. I'm always saddened when I end up with these orphan cheetahs that come in. They're cute. However, they don't really want to be in captivity at all. Hand-raising cheetahs and having them purr and lick your hand is lovely. However, that's not something that I want. I want cheetahs to be living out in the wild.
The center currently hosts two different types of cheetah, permanent residents and those earmarked for reintroduction into the wild. Meals are served to the permanent guests first.
Cats are usually at the far of their end here. And then to hear the car come, we honk and it's a response that they know that they're gonna get their food.
Most of the fund's cheetahs have been handed over by farmers. This particular case illustrates a sad reality. A mother was killed because she was a threat to cattle. After her death, the farmers found her litter of baby cheetahs nearby and called the CCF, which took them in. They grew up here, where they were looked after with the greatest care.
Good exercise. One for you and one for you. Okay, go ahead and you're gonna have to get another, A little bit lazy today. Come on, come.
Laurie Marker never lets them forget their gift for speed. As in the wild, the cheetah's survival depends on its ability to sprint. The race continues. Not all the residents in this vast enclosure have appeared yet, and staff have to make sure that each one has its share of food. Cheetahs have high dietary requirements, 3 kilos of meat a day. In their natural environment, they can get by with a successful hunt every 2 or 3 days. Unlike other great predators, cheetahs hunt during the day and so avoid their main competitors, hyenas and lions.
Here you go, come on. That's a big piece. Come on, big girl.
These tame cheetahs cannot be released into the wild. They weren't with their mother long enough to learn the basics of hunting.
Yeah, now we got two.
Now, Laurie Marker's team heads over to an enclosure where animals have been selected for reintroduction into the wild. How are they different to the cheetahs in the previous area?
Well, by their behavior.
As soon as the gate is opened, the cats pounce on the food. These animals are much shyer than their fellows and have all the qualities needed for successful release. They are unsettled by the presence of humans.
So there's really a distinct difference between the cheetahs that we run and their behavior with people, and animals like this that are, you know, are ready to be rewilded. And so you can see she hates us. Coming in at about 8 months of age, they cannot go back out into the wild until they're old enough, big enough. The biggest problem with that, though, is finding a place for them to go. So you can't just take them and put them all out around here because we already have cheetahs here. And then finding other areas where there's not a lot of people and their livestock, and other areas where there's a lot of wildlife.
That is the great challenge for the successful reintroduction of cheetahs into a natural environment, space. Namibia has the world's largest cheetah population, between 3,500 and 4,000 individuals out of a total population of 10,000. In Namibia, 95% of the animals roam on farmland, which is always dangerous. Cheetahs are used to vast open spaces and their competition with humans is fierce and often deadly. Okay. It is D-Day for this female named Zena. Laurie's teams have just anesthetized her and are preparing to fit her with a transmitter collar. She will be released in a few days. They planned to capture another female, Luna, but she refuses to be lured into an ambush. While the final adjustments are made to Zena's collar before it's fitted, she's subjected to a series of tests. The staff's movements are quick and precise. The different samples taken, blood in particular, will be recorded in the fund's database. Another attempt is made to catch Luna. Once the measurements are made, the collar is adjusted on Zina. The animal will wear it for 3 months before it comes off by itself. The data collected each day will enable regular monitoring of the cat's movements so Laurie can map her former guest's hunting grounds and visualize her life in the wild.
Can you stretch her out?
Okay, Zina is ready now. She's been allocated a frequency and is returned to her crate before she wakes. Since the fund was set up in 1990, Laurie Marker has released more than 400 animals. When she settled in Namibia, the cheetah population was in decline. Today, it hasn't just stabilized, it's more than doubled in 20 years.
Okay. She's gonna go down in a second.
Let's go.
She's about 4.5 years of age. She's been here since she was about 7 months of age. She's in excellent condition, and we think that she's gonna have a great chance of going out and rewilding, learning how to hunt.
The drug begins to work and Luna slumps. Again, nothing is left to chance. The animal's capture provides an opportunity for a general medical checkup. Laurie carefully orchestrates operations. Luna is also equipped with a transmitter collar and allocated a frequency. The two females will be released on land belonging to the fund, but they won't remain together because only males live in groups. Zina is wide awake and bolts as soon as her crate is opened.
Our Luna now is in the pen. She's waking up in her box, so we'll release her in just a couple minutes. From there, Zina's already out here. We'll monitor them out here then for the next few days and then release the main gate, and they'll be out in Bellabino.
Luna emerges from her crate too. Still woozy from the anesthetic, she staggers to the middle of her enclosure. She doesn't realize yet, but now that she has her collar, freedom is just a step away. At the Cheetah Conservation Fund, the ultimate goal, the daily struggle, is to readapt the animals. Every aspect of this battle is interconnected. Many scientific research projects are carried out at the CCF. One of them has lasted 14 years, a detailed study of how vegetation encroaches on the cat's territory. Research assistant Maddie is heading the project. He and Kenneth, a student at Windhoek Polytechnic in the Namibian capital, enter the initial data they've collected in the field. As usual, High Priestess Laurie supervises proceedings.
Okay, I'm gonna head out.
Okay.
There is still one zone to be studied to obtain an overall view of the way in which spaces are overgrown and identify the plants involved. The greater the spread of vegetation, the more radical the change in environment. What would happen if vegetation suddenly became too dense? This research provides vital background information for initiatives to restore the cheetah's habitat. The fund owns more than 40,000 hectares of land. Intelligence and hard work are needed to manage such a large area. Each zone covers an area of vegetation that requires careful monitoring. Laurie, Maddie, and Kenneth haven't visited this one for a long time. A post set in concrete provides a reference point for observation and photography.
Go that way to the right, your left. Keep going a little bit more.
Yep. About here?
Yep. I think that we've lost a tree since. So this is sort of a habitat that we'd look at trying to model as we're doing our harvesting. A lot of our visibility studies go along with us down at cheetah eyesight level. And if you look at what it looks like, you can see. But if you get into the thick and thorn bush there, you really, from a cheetah level, figure out that you can't see much.
This is a race against time. Without a suitable habitat, cheetahs cannot survive. Again, every factor is linked, related, interdependent. There can be no predators without prey. If the cheetah is to survive, its ecosystem must be restored rationally. Laurie Marker has found a way to conserve the great open spaces where cheetahs can help maintain a natural balance. She set up teams of savanna gardeners. When areas are identified where action is needed, these workers carefully examine the different varieties of trees and eliminate undesirable species. Bruce is the fund's general manager and also Laurie's partner in life. He keeps a close eye on these projects.
The project is aimed at habitat restoration to both create jobs, to open the habitat somewhat, so it's better for the wildlife, including, of course, the cheetah, but also as an industrial process to put a value on the bush so that more people can afford to do some habitat restoration.
And then if there's more areas that are open, we can have more cheetahs.
Research has shown that 10 to 12 million hectares have been invaded by harmful shrubs in Namibia. Once these plants have been cut and shredded, they are processed by extrusion to make fuel sticks with nearly the energy value of coal. This simple process could eventually provide a solution to supply local markets with fuel. This morning, Laurie has arranged to meet one of her pilot friends, Jacques. He wants to fly over the Waterberg Plateau region to make sure that Zena and Luna have remained in the area following their release last week.
There's two cheetahs over here.
Somewhere on the big field, huh?
Yeah.
Okay, we go to the big field.
This radio telemetry operation is conducted in a plane equipped with antennas to pick up the animal's signals.
As soon as you get the signal, you tell me.
Yep, keep on going.
Yes, I do. I will just climb out a little more so that we get a better reception.
I'm on scan right now, so we should be able to start moving.
The search begins. The Waterberg Plateau is a very special conservation area. Here, users of farm and common land work together. Groups of farmers jointly manage their resources, and so the wild animals that live on the land too. The zone covers almost 2 million hectares.
Go that way.
Left, yeah. Right. Okay, to the right.
Yeah. More straight on as we go down. Okay, I think he's just right around here. It sounded
okay.
Good. Okay, go up. And then we're going to have to come back around.
Okay.
Okay. He's just right in here. Just
there
an
we
idea
are.
Of where he's.
It was nicely and quickly done. Perfect.
Yes.
So I think a lot of people, when they look and hear that I live in Africa and work with cheetahs, they think that I have a dream life. However, the work that's really entailed in saving a cheetah isn't necessarily a dream. It's a harsh reality of, in many respects, people who are living in poor livelihoods, their livestock being oftentimes caught by predators and the cheetah. I see a lot of sad things. I have to pick up cheetahs from trap cages that shouldn't have been trapped, but a farmer did it because he was perceiving it to be a problem to their livelihoods or their livestock. But I found that farmers were killing cheetahs like flies. So I realized that farmers were actually a really important part of a reintroduction program.
For more than 20 years, Laurie has been tirelessly promoting awareness among farmers, but is still a long way from achieving her goal, peaceful coexistence.
talking to the other farmers and saying, well, how can we live together with predators? It was sort of to actually practice what you preach. Previously, I mean, 15, 20 years ago, we didn't really have an idea of the kinds of home ranges cheetahs have. Our radio telemetry allowed us to start learning a little bit more about those individual cheetahs and how they are overlapping on our farms and other farms. Even today with our camera traps up, we regularly can say, oh, well, here's a leopard area and here's a cheetah area. Although we actually can see the tracks as well. We manage our land and know our land quite well around here.
You can also expect that farmers will be upset if they lose cattle. The fact is, what do you do about it? I mean, it's easy to say, I don't like cheetahs and I want to shoot every cheetah that I see, because you don't want to do anything about your cattle. You don't want to get involved in their management or so. If everything is scheduled and you know when the cows will give birth and you make a plan around that to bring them a little bit closer and have them under the eye and so on, you can prevent a lot of conflict with these predators. But the biggest thing for me is, if you look around, if you drive around this country, there's very few places that you won't find game or wildlife. If you realize that you share with the wildlife, with predators and everything, then this is in essence what makes us more successful.
For a long time, cheetahs were hunted, but they seem to have an easier life these days. Attitudes are changing. Lori has organized a certified cheetah-friendly meat initiative. The idea is simple. Cattle ranchers who cooperate are paid a little extra when they sell their meat. This also means that consumers, some of them European, are helping to protect cheetahs. The initiative is of vital importance because 95% of the cheetah population comes into contact with cattle.
He's marking his territory, he's urinating on the tree, defecating, letting the other cheetahs that do come here know that he is around. These marking trees are a very important part of the cheetah's territoriality. They are constantly on the move, their home ranges are large. A home range for a cheetah is about 1,600 square kilometers. And if you look out here, not very many trees really are something that a cheetah can climb up into. So these marking trees are very important for the cheetah. People had actually heard about the crazy American woman who liked cheetahs. And I went systematically sort of through the farming country. And there were a few people who'd say to me, you like cheetahs, you know, take them all back to America with you. And then other people would say, well, you know, if you're gonna do anything for long term for the cheetah, you really need to like set your roots in here. You know, you should become a farmer too and find out, you know, what it's like to be a farmer.
Lunch is being prepared in the laboratory, but this time the hungry animals aren't cats. When Lori Marker created the fund, she also set up a farm. She initially studied wine growing before she began to look after cheetahs full time. Keen to be an organic farmer, she also majored in wild fauna management, followed by biology and zoology.
I'm an old goat farmer from my first life. I started raising goats when I was young, and I had a dairy goat farm. So when I moved here to Namibia, I had livestock guarding dogs and, of course, needed goats.
Here again, her work gradually changed outlooks. Lori's farm lent weight to her main argument. Predators, cattle, and humans can all live together. Her crazy idea took root, but still more practical solutions were needed to protect the herds. So Lori had the idea of breeding dogs, Anatolian shepherds, and giving them to farmers. Over the last 20 years, the results have fulfilled all her expectations. Cheetahs are wary animals and find it too dangerous to approach a herd watched by a dog. A single bark will keep them at bay.
Here, you want to go to your new family? There you go.
Laurie is always keen to make sure everything goes perfectly. As she hands over a puppy to farmers, she gives them final advice.
She needs to trust you, but she's grown up with her flock. She needs to be with her flock. And a big thing is when you give her her food, that you make sure that she eats her food and the goats are not bothering her.
Yeah.
They don't want to have to turn around and say, go away, goat, bark, bark, because their goats are their family.
In the age-old conflict between predators and farmers, Laurie is never short of new ideas to help her protégés. This young border collie has been specially trained to find clues that hold valuable information, spore. By extracting the DNA in animal droppings, Laurie's teams can identify individuals, assess the density of population, and better grasp its distribution. This extensive research program also aims to show that cheetahs prefer to hunt game rather than attack cattle.
Find a new cheetah in the area. That would be great.
Anne Schmidt-Kunzel joined Laurie's teams in 2008. Anne is a geneticist at the CCF. Once the droppings have been washed, only the hairs of the cheetah and its prey remain. The young German biologist who came to work as an intern with the CCF can now compare them with samples of hair from different herbivores.
So far was just steenbok and cheetah, you know, because they're cleaning themselves and then you found the hair. Yeah, so I found cheetah because it's, you know, changing with a pattern up the hair, and steenbok because it was all regular waved.
Oh, great. Okay, so yet another sample where there's no domestic animals.
This good news confirms Laurie Marker's belief that cheetahs would rather eat an antelope than a calf. Today, she presents her team's research results to a group of local farmers.
Doctor, the floor is yours. You are welcome. Thank you.
I am from the Cheetah Conservation Fund, and I know some of you have been over conflict issue, is that it's not going to be necessarily dealt with by the government. I guess I'm a tough lady. I've had to actually walk into a man's world, and I don't like that. I've had to be tough in looking at life and death.
Chewbacca, the fund's ambassador and mascot for many years, passed away.
It was a sad time for him to go away the way he did, so he went down as a warrior, and it was a very unexpected accident that he had. He tried to kill a kudu, and the kudu gave him such injuries that he died of infection and the injury, so it was a traumatic time for all of us. He was such a good friend and such an ambassador, and everybody knew him. He was a very special cheetah. And then to carry his message forward, it continues to be part of my job as well, and I'm asked about it regularly and will always, because he has been such an important part of CCF's life and my life. There's a great story here in Africa where they talk about, it's called the living legend, where if one person remembers that person, then that person will be the legend forever and ever.
Since that sad day, Chewbacca has been replaced by four new ambassadors. 20,000 years ago, cheetahs flourished over four continents, Africa, Asia, Europe, and North America. But around 12,000 years ago, climate change led to a dramatic reduction in their populations. Cheetahs began to mate with close relatives, impoverishing their gene pool.
My bigger interest then started trying to understand more about the overall health of them and got involved in the genetic makeup and understanding that they lack genetic diversity. So in the early 80s, was involved with a group from the Smithsonian and the National Cancer Institute in the United States, where we started studying our cheetahs, the blood and the tissues, and realized that they were genetically the same. And from that, started finding out too much about, unfortunately, some of the diseases of them and the problems reproductively. So from that, it launched me off into just years and years of intensive research that we've been able to answer a lot of questions here in Namibia.
The fund's residents are regularly captured and given full medical checkups. Now in the late afternoon, the veterinary team brings a male to the clinic.
Hey, let's go, come on, let's go. Sheree, get it. Let's get him on.
Although the staff are old hands at the job, this type of procedure is never entirely without risk. Laurie Marker's many research projects have shown that almost all cheetahs have very similar genes. Animals of the same species generally share around 80% of genes, but because of inbreeding, this figure has reached almost 99% in cheetahs, making them virtually identical genetically. A viral outbreak or epidemic would be a disaster. The whole population could die out.
We take the blood samples to look at the overall health and the genetic makeup, looking at how he compares to some of the other cheetahs. Stable.
Once a sample has been taken, Anne, the geneticist, conducts standard tests to determine the animal's general state of health. Tests show that cheetah blood proteins are as uniform as ever, a sign of catastrophic inbreeding.
So now let's go and collect the sperm. So Kate, are you ready?
Okay. We'll do. Now just stay on.
You're gonna go. Are you going two?
Yeah, we can go up to
two. A sperm sample is taken by internal electrical stimulation.
Three.
Yeah.
Okay. Good. Do a little slower.
Just don't forget the photo.
I think you got something.
Okay, you've got one. I'll grab these two. Okay, so let's go give that one a try. I'll grab these others, and we can at least measure and see what we've got, okay?
The samples taken are studied in the laboratory. Again, because of inbreeding, sperm quality is very poor, and the spermatozoa are often abnormal. This sample is no different. On the right of the screen is a spermatozoon with a curled flagellum taken from the cheetah. On the left, a normal spermatozoon. The difference speaks volumes. The CCF freezes its resident sperm as part of a vast zoo exchange program. In 2000, world-famous news magazine Time presented Laurie Marker with an award for her work and worldview. Winners of the greatest distinctions, including the Tyler Prize, the equivalent of the Nobel, Laurie Marker and her team of scientists have been doing groundbreaking research to improve our knowledge of cheetahs since the early 90s. Each year, the fund welcomes many students and volunteers keen to help with the protection of cheetahs worldwide. In the fund's busy day, the lunch break is a moment of calm where everybody can relax. Orchestrating their shared enthusiasm, Laurie takes the chance to ask about everyone's work.
I don't think I have any regrets. Well, there wouldn't be twice as many cheetahs in Namibia. There wouldn't be cheetah programs throughout Africa and Asia. I didn't have children, but I've had everybody else's children. I get everybody's kids when they come in at 18 years old, and all of my interns that are here, who are now, after 30-some years, out being some of the best scientists, veterinarians there are in the world. So I've spread a different kind of a gene, I'm going to say, and that is a conservation message.
Today, Laurie welcomes a group of students from Iran. Every year, the CCF organizes symposiums where the teams bring participants up to speed on the latest techniques and provide training for future generations of researchers.
I'm really proud of working with my friends in Iran. I've been working with them since 2000 and actively being there, working with them, helping them and the government develop the strategy to save the cheetahs in Iran. And we've trained a lot of the conservation scientists over here in Namibia, as well as some of their government employees. They're very keen on reversing the decline of the cheetah population.
With an estimated population of 50 to 100 individuals, the Asiatic or Iranian cheetah is seriously endangered. Mohammed Faradinia, representing the Iranian Cheetah Society, presents pictures taken by automatically triggered cameras to the team of rangers from the Kavir National Park. The results are very encouraging. A new cheetah has been identified. Four years ago, a male cheetah was captured and introduced into a natural environment. Today, the Iranian scientists want to capture a female to begin a breeding program, so increasing the species' chances of survival. The Asiatic cheetah is slightly different to its African cousin. Its coat is lighter in shade, and it has a short mane on its neck. The outlook is bleak for the Iranian cheetah. The rarer they are, the harder it is for populations to renew themselves. For Laurie, the future of Africa is closely linked to the destiny of the cheetah. She is full of ideas and acts as the spokesperson for those who cannot speak for themselves.
Africa is my home, and I think I'm a realist. If I didn't think that the cheetah had a future, I think I'd probably just go sit under a tree someplace and be like that eland that passed away. But I don't think I have a second on earth that I'm not saving the cheetah. So everybody I meet, I know that if they aren't interested in saving the cheetah, they will be after I've met them.
So Lori carries on her work, convinced that everyone can do what she does. Try, give it their best effort, and never quit for the good of all.